This program is brought to you by thepodcastfactory.com.
How would you like to get more customers, make more profits, and have bigger breakthroughs? Get Doberman Dan's profit-boosting breakthroughs. Normally, this would cost you $98 per month, but right now, for listening to this show, he's giving you a free copy of his Doberman Dan letter. All you have to do is go to DobermanDan.com and sign up to get your free copy now.
Prepare yourself for the uncensored, nothing held back, no BS reality of how business and life really work. Doberman Dan is off the chain.
What's up, canine crew? You're listening to the Off the Chain show with your man, Doberman Dan. Last week, we were talking to Craig Ballantyne about how to have the perfect day, and things were just heating up before we had a cut out. So we're back this week with part two of Craig Ballantyne, How to Have the Perfect Day. Let's jump into it.
My day didn't go perfectly today. How can I improve it? They just think, oh, my day didn't go perfectly today, and I bet you tomorrow won't either. So I just already give up, you know, they live life reactively. But it's those proactive people who think the way that you think and who try and figure out ways to block your time and batch your work. Those are the people that are the successful ones. And the people that everyone else looks at and goes, I don't know how they do it all.
Right. I hear that sometimes. Not that I'm, you know, I'm not gonna say I got my act 100% together in this regard. I think I do better than most. I'm doing a lot better now over the past year and a half or 2 years because of actually similar issues you were having, Craig. I was forced to get better at this. But may I share some of my concerns? Well, I'm going to share some of my concerns anyway, because it's my show. So I'm kind of playing devil's advocate here because I hear this from people, but that this is actually something I'm dealing with myself. But actually, let me put a pin in the one is email. We'll get back to that. Because I swear to you, that is the bane of my existence. I rue the day Al Gore invented it. But so the Doberman Dan presented in publication and oftentimes in person is the amplified Dan Gallipoo. Okay. It's the best version of Dan Gallipoo. Dan Gallipoo is a nice guy and has suffered as a result of that nice guy syndrome. I mean, when people think you're a nice guy, they'll screw you over. So one of the things I struggle with, there are simply people, I've got hundreds of people I feel that are pulling the hem of my garment, you know, and they just want a quick minute, okay? Multiply that times 100, okay? They just want a quick phone call. They just want a quick something. They just want a quick email answer. Here's what I hear in my head when I hear this or when they pull you aside and they say what they want to say. Whatever they say, I don't hear. Here's what I hear. Dan, really, I'm not going to ask for much from you. All I want from you today is a bone marrow transplant. and multiply that by 100 people. So the nice guy in me in the past has said yes to these things. And some of these aren't just business contacts. Some of these are people in my personal life who need to be cut out of my life. And I just did this week, okay? So a guy got a phone call to me who didn't deserve a phone call and shouldn't have. And it was partly my fault. It was partly, I'll take it. So it was mostly my fault. I didn't communicate with my assistant correctly, the parameters, but so he got the phone call. Here's what I'm getting at. The nice guy syndrome doesn't want people's feelings to be hurt. The nice guy syndrome wants to continue looking like a nice guy. And it damn near killed me. Because you can't give just a few minutes or a quick email question answer to a couple hundred people. Do you deal with that? Do you have clients that deal with that? How do you deal with that?
That's a great question. And everybody who's got, you know, followers, fans, all that sort of stuff knows how that's going to be like. And so one of the best ways I've ever seen anyone dealing with it, I can't remember this woman's name, but she's a Christian author, and you can contact her company and, you know, they say and say like, hey, I'd love to have a conversation with this person. I'd love to, you know, do an interview with this person. And you get this form email back that says, I really appreciate your feedback or your question, but I'm busy doing God's work right now and writing my new books and working on this, and this. And so I can't afford to take time out of my day to do it. And I think it's really valuable because, you know, like, what if, you know, Steve Jobs was like, hey, you know what? I'll go down to the customer service department and just start answering phone calls all day about the new iPhone. Do you think like the iPhone 7 would have ever come out? No. I mean,
he'd still be on version one.
And so, you know, like Oprah's not taking everybody's calls and all these other people are not taking everybody's calls because they're out there doing stuff that matters. Like if The Rock was answering every person's email or comment on Facebook, he wouldn't film any more movies. And so eventually you just have to say, listen, I will do 1 hour a week where I will do an open Q&A on Facebook. If you want to ask me your question there, great. It'll be fun. You know, I'll have a Mai Tai or something while I do it. I don't even know what's in a Mai Tai, but you know, like it's just like some type of beachy drink and, you know, I'm going to do it and we're going to have fun, but that's all I have time for. Because the rest of the time I'm doing, you can say God's work, you can say, you know, the universe's plan. I'm working on these big things that really matter, that move the needle ahead. And for anybody listening that has children, this one should hit home for you. So listen, every single time that you answer some stranger's question, whether you get on the phone with them or whatever, you're stealing minutes from your children. And so when you go home and you're on your iPhone and the kid wants to play with you, but you're like, you know, you're kicking the soccer ball with them, but you're not even looking up and you're hurting your child's feelings so that you can get back to some stranger in Podunk, Iowa. I don't know what Podunk is. Kennedy's always great. He uses like, you know, these really strange places that I've never heard of. But, you know, you're answering a stranger's question and you're doing a nice thing for somebody, but it's at the expense of your child, your girlfriend, your spouse. You know, you are ruining home relationships in order to be addicted to social media or email to help somebody that you'll never meet and who probably will take your free advice and do what everybody else does with free advice, which is nothing. And yeah, I learned this the hard way because I once did a program for Men's Health Magazine where I designed 6 workout programs for these guys. I probably spent 20 hours on this. And they were giving it to these guys for free for a transformation program. And it was 6 weeks long. And one guy lasted 2 weeks.
Huh.
And that was the slap in the face for me to never devote a ton of time to free advice. I have a rule that I do at least. I help a non-customer for 5 minutes every day. But, you know, that's 5 minutes. And so I'll go on. I answer questions on social media, but just 5 minutes. And then I'm back and, you know, I got books to write. I got 25 books I want to write in my life. I already know the titles for the first 10. I've got 5 done, but those books aren't going to write themselves and they're not going to get written if I'm jumping all over the place and giving free advice to people who won't use it.
That's true. Speaking of upcoming books, I want to talk about one in a minute, but first I want to pick your brain about email. I can understand why Kennedy doesn't use email, Dan Kennedy. Mm-hmm. I have another real high performer, entrepreneur friend, decamillionaire, doesn't use email anymore. I mean, like handful of people have his email. The rest of the people, the email he had is now an autoresponder that tells them a number to call. He actually gave his direct cell phone number. And he was keeping track of it for a while. And the number of emails he got from people was in the thousands. And the number of phone calls he got, because the autoresponder message said, I don't answer my email anymore, period. Nobody will ever even see this email. So whatever your issue is, here's my cell phone number, call me. After over 2,000 emails he kept track of that came in to that account, he received 3 phone calls.
Wow.
Really?
So that tells me like, those thousands of emails, which would have wasted God knows how much of his time, none of them were important. If they were important enough, those people would have called him. So I know high performers not using email. I understand the reasons why I like certain things about email, but here's why I say it's the bane of my existence. I feel that it's never, ever complete. I have to check it. at least once a day. It seems like if I go more than a couple days, they start to stack up and then I feel that anxiety. And it's like, they're never, ever going to stop coming in. That's probably just a problem in my head, but I don't know. Maybe you've helped other people deal with that.
Yeah, it's actually a great question. I have dealt with it myself, where I was actually about 2 years ago, my business allowed me to just check email. I just checked email every other day for 3 days a week for like 2 hours. And so I realized that, Dan, all those emails that stack up, you can get through them so fast if you let them stack up. So it's actually better to check it less. And then you go in there, and here's what I do is I don't even go directly into the email inbox. So I use Gmail. And so if you've searched for somebody's name in your Gmail, like let's say you have a friend named Trevor, you can type in Trevor into your Google bar, whatever search, you know, I don't even know what that's called, you know, the top bar, and mm-hmm. it'll show Gmail search Trevor. And then I'll click on that and it'll take me into my Gmail, but not into my regular inbox. And so then I'll see, you know, if there's a, you know, the name Trevor in an email, it'll show up as a bold email, as a new email. But then I can just search, and I can search for all the emails from my business partner, Matt. And I can search for all the emails from my business partner, Bedros. And I can search for all the emails about my workshops. And I don't even have to go into my inbox to read the important stuff. And then once I've gone through all the important stuff, if I still have time, then I'll go into my inbox and I'll be through it. I can get through about 50 emails probably in about 30 minutes because, like you said, most of them are not important. Most of them resolve themselves. And most of them are just, you know, like you think you're off an email list and somehow they're still emailing you 3 years later. You know, like when they switch over to a new newsletter provider, you end up starting to get emails from something that you unsubscribed from 5 years ago because they start to email all their contacts again. And so you'll be amazed at how fast you get through your email. And so basically what you're doing now is you're training yourself to be able to be fine with checking your email less. And you're training yourself to get through your email faster. And at the end of the day, you realize, hey, you know what? Most of this stuff doesn't matter. And the people that are important with the emergencies, they have my mobile phone number. They can text me or call me. And that's it. And so now you just go, you just start to slowly reduce your stress. It's just like someone who is going to say, I'm going to quit smoking by taking longer in between my cigarettes. I don't even know if that works, but I know some people have tried it. So you say, instead of having a cigarette every 3 hours, I'm not going to have a cigarette for 3 hours and 15 minutes. And I'm going to work my way up until it's 3 hours and 30 minutes, and then 4 hours, and 5 hours, 6 hours. And you same with your email. I'm only going to check my email every other day. Okay, I did it. Whew. The world didn't end. This is fun.
Wow.
This is kind of fun because I had a really focused day and I really look forward to the 90 minute block of email I have the next day, which is kind of like entertaining to see how useless it is. And then maybe you get down to 2 emails per week. But, you know, you can train yourself to overcome that, just like you've trained yourself to get down to 1 checking of email per day, or, you know, you trained yourself to write 3,000 words a day. Whatever you've trained yourself to do, everything's a learnable skill and you can improve upon it and get better at it. So I know that you're capable of doing whatever you want with email. And the only other thing I'll add is if you don't check email very often, don't be one of those people who has an autoresponder that says you only check email a certain number of times.
Because really I was annoying. Just going to ask that. Yeah.
Oh, man, I was setting mine up already.
Here's my favorite, Dan. Somebody emails me and I email them back and I get the autoresponder that says I'm only checking email. You know, listen, that's fine if I emailed you out of the blue. But if you're emailing me and then I email you back and I have to get one of your stupid autoresponders that says you're only checking email every 2 days, that's inconsiderate. It's like the telemarketers that call you with an automated message and you have to listen, like that's annoying. And so same with the autoresponders.
I'm glad you clarified that. I probably would have done that too. Like, oh, this is great. I'm going to do Craig's plan, but I better put an autoresponder letting everybody know that, yeah, listen, if they can't wait 2 days, to get an email reply, then they shouldn't be used in email. Then it's obviously something of an urgent nature.
You know what else is most people forget they emailed you. Like, think about the average person. They probably send out like 50 or 100 emails over the course of the day. And I was just thinking this today. I'm like, I wonder if I emailed that guy that thing that he wanted. I don't even remember because, you know, I send out 20 emails a day and I just forget. And so most people who email you asking you a question probably forget that they emailed you anyways.
Hmm.
That's how little value they put on email. And then so one other thing that I've actually done like this 20-minute webinar on how to get no email and for my clients. And so one other thing is that your inbox is your responsibility. So if you want it to be empty, don't send email. Because if you send an email, you know you're getting one back. And so I also say treat email like a fax. Think of how hard it is to go and send a fax. You have to, you know, summarize your thoughts, and then you have to go over to the fax machine. You have to send it. If you treated your emails like fax and you realize, hey, if I'm going to send this fax, I really have to make sure that my thoughts are coherent here. Most people don't think that. They're just like, oh, I'll just put some verbal diarrhea into this email and send it instead of actually thinking about, okay, you know, here's question number one that I want answered. Here's question number two. You know, if you had to submit your emails for publication or something, you'd actually put more thought into it. You'd get the answers you wanted, and you wouldn't have to have an email chain of 10 emails because, you know, email's free and it doesn't cost you any resources, you think, but it does if you do it poorly.
Hmm. That's a very good observation because it's just too easy to fire off a brain fart email or fire off like 40 of them. When you should have thought ahead and planned it out and summarized what you were going to say into one email.
Yeah, and a couple of other things. So would you fax somebody back something that says, thank you? No, you're not going to fax a thank you note to somebody, but we get caught in this email chain of thank you, you're welcome. Nah, no problem. No, really, my pleasure. And it's like, you know, like 10 emails going back and forth. Like you have that end of a phone call awkwardness where you're like, okay, I'll talk to you later. Yeah, see ya. Thanks. You know, it's just really awkward. But if you look at it this way, if you say, okay, it costs me, I get 10 emails for free a day, and every email above and beyond that, I have to burn a dollar bill. You know, there's a pretty good way to get you to stop sending email, right?
Ouch. Yeah.
You know, because even if it's just a dollar, nobody likes to burn a buck, right? Or, you know, like give it to, or because I spend a lot of time in Denver, I say if I swear, it costs me, I have to give $100 to like the homeless potheads in Denver, and I don't want to do that because they're everywhere in Denver, downtown Denver. And so there's got to be consequences. Like if you really want to change your email situation, there's got to be consequences to it. And so you can have a little jar beside you and you put the dollar bill in after you go above 10 emails and then you burn that money at the end of the day. And then one other thing, Dan, is just get people to understand that if you put NNTR at the bottom of your emails, it means no need to reply. And that's the end of the conversation. And you'll save yourself a lot of emails.
Oh, I like that tip. I like the tip about the putting the money in the jar and burning it or giving it to some charity I despise. Because right. I think it's a perfect analogy for how I'm viewing it nowadays. You know, you're a young guy, Craig, but I'm 52 now. And like statistically speaking, I ain't got but about 20 years left. Now, 34 years ago, I graduated from high school. And in my mind, that feels like about 12, 15 years ago. That's how fast 34 years goes. So if I only have another 20 years or so, statistically speaking, I am wasting my life in stupid emails, talking to people I probably don't want to talk to when I could be doing the things I want to do. So the putting the money in the jar and then burning it at the end of the day is a great metaphor for what email does, except it's even worse than that. It's not my money being burned. It's my limited life.
Yeah. It is actually a really great metaphor. And it's just hopefully that will help some people overcome the overwhelm of email. And, you know, I used to be really stressed out by like going into my email inbox, but now I've set it up so that, you know, the email that comes in is good email. You know, it's opportunities to do really big stuff, whether it's about my workshops or whether it's about books or something. And most other people, they just, you know, I did go through a phase where I had to be like that grumpy old Kennedy and kind of give that attitude to people and that persona to people, like, hey, I won't answer your email, so don't send it to me. But, you know, now I'm a gentler and kinder persona, and but people still just don't waste my time with email. They send very structured email, and it's been really helpful. So it's just a matter of clear expectations, and you can do it without being, you know, grumpy and curmudgeon-y. Just say, hey, listen, I'm working on this new project. You don't even tell them what it is, but it's like my life's work, and, you know, it is. And I just can't be responding to a lot of emails. I don't check it very often. So if you don't hear from me, don't worry about it. But, you know, we'll catch up soon.
That's perfect. That's I don't think anybody would be offended by that. And if they are, so be it. I want to go down a different track for a second, but then yep. I want to come back to the perfect day formula. I hope you're not going to roll your eyes when I start talking about fitness stuff. But because no. So I recently got back into shape about the end of June last year, beginning of July last year. I was a rather pudgy dude, in spite of the fact that I was still lifting weights a couple of days a week. I mean, I just, there was no commitment and I was eating all kinds of garbage and I was pretty fat. So I made a commitment to get back into shape, but old school style, how I did it back in the day. I hate cardio. I wasn't going to do it. I never found it effective. I've always found it counterproductive to me. So I went seriously old school, like 1960s old school Vince Guaranda style training, if you remember that name, the old Iron yeah. Guru.
Eight sets of eight and that sort of thing.
Yep, exactly. I was not in good shape, Craig. I started with six sets of six, but I don't want to bore all the people who will be bored by our geeky fitness stuff, but so I started with 60 seconds rest between sets, and that was killing me. But then I got it down to 30 seconds rest between sets, six sets of six, and then finally down to 15 seconds between sets. Wow. And still handling, you know, the same weights I started with when I rested 60 seconds. So completely resistance training combined with basically a paleo diet, but I mean, nothing but green veggies and animal products. And how quickly I got back into shape was really scary. Like about 9 weeks, I started seeing abs again. Not a six pack, but I, you know, started seeing the top two rows.
A little keg.
Yeah, going from a keg to a four pack. So when I saw your upcoming book called The Great Cardio Myth, I had to ask you about that. What is that book about?
Great question. And so the book is really about, hey, here's what you don't need cardio for. It doesn't help you lose weight. You know, there's plenty of research in there. There's studies that show people who do 300 hours of cardio in a year, that's an hour of cardio 6 days a week for 50 weeks, they lost 5 pounds. What a terrible waste of time. And it's more about body weight training and some more metabolic resistance training. So very short workouts. There's a study that showed people that did, young women that did 4 minutes of high intensity exercise got the same aerobic fitness boost as someone who did 30 minutes of slow cardio. And so there's all that sort of stuff in there. And it's funny that you ask the question today, because on the weekend I did one of those executive medical assessments, like a full on, it was 4 hours. You do all these testings and give blood and all this stuff. And I don't do cardio, and they have a cardio test in there where you go out in the treadmill and like there's a certain time period, and I beat it. I mean, I beat the tests that they have, and then I destroyed all their other fitness tests. And, you know, I'm 41 years old, 11% body fat. Usually it's 10, but it was 11 with this test. And my resting heart rate's really low. My blood pressure is 110 over 75. And I follow a similar diet to you. I eat a lot of fruits and I eat potatoes. So I know that's not hardcore paleo, but, you know, it's very similar. It's just really one ingredient foods. And so I follow that program just like you do. And I'm in great shape. And I do a little less volume in my weight training, but I'm still decently strong. And they rarely see somebody who comes in there to these executive medical fitness tests and health tests that has everything in place. And they were asking me like, oh, what kind of cardio do you do? And I said, I don't do any. And they looked at me like, oh, my goodness, you don't? They actually insulted me and asked me if I did CrossFit. And I said, no, I don't. Because, well, the reason why I joke about that goes back to, you know, what we talked about at the start of this call, when I was getting my help from Tom Venuto and he helped me get turbulence training out to the world on a bigger scale. I started getting all this hate mail from CrossFitters. in 2006. And, you know, they were like, oh, this just sounds like a CrossFit ripoff. And I had never actually been to the CrossFit website. I had heard of it, but I'd never been to the website. My program came out before I ever heard of CrossFit. But, you know, CrossFit invented exercise, of course. And so yeah. I would get all this hate mail. And so that's why I say it was an insult that this person asked me if I did CrossFit. But, you know, CrossFit does have a lot of benefits to it, you know, community aspect. But most importantly, getting women to wear knee-high socks is the most important CrossFit has brought to the world. So bottom line is that, yeah, I mean, people can get fit without doing slow cardio. I mean, it's the most boring thing in the world, probably. They don't need to do it. You've proven it. Diet's the most important thing if you want to lose fat. And it's the most important thing if you want to have good cardiovascular health. And then exercise is a nice addition.
I agree. When all those things are fine-tuned working together, it's amazing how fast the changes can happen. 2 years before I made that decision to get back into shape, 2 years prior to that, I've always been in good health, really. Blood pressure's always been perfect. Pulse has always been really good. But 2 years prior to that decision to get back into shape, my blood pressure was running anywhere from 150, 160 over high 90s to 110.
Wow.
For 2 years. Pulse was always running at least 100. High 90s, 100, a little more than 100, you know, which is, I mean, some people that might not be unusual. For me, that's very unusual. And again, 2 months time, man, a blood pressure right back down to normal, right? 120 over 80. I now got the pulse in the mid 60s and not a single lick of cardio. So there, all these people think cardio is a religion and is what's going to save them from all those things, high blood pressure, being overweight. I say fooey to it.
Exactly. They don't need it. And in fact, most people, it's almost like exercise bulimia, which is, you know, they justify their diet choices with the idea that, hey, I can go to the gym tomorrow and burn it off. No, you can't. You know, it takes for someone to burn 1,000 calories in an hour, they have to exercise at such an intense exercise level that only like a 25-year-old guy could pull it off. And so really, most people are burning about 300 calories in 45 minutes on a machine. 300 calories above and beyond what they would burn if they just sat on a couch. And most people would burn about 100 calories if they just sat on the couch. And the cardio machines have been proven to overestimate the number of calories that you burn. So if you're on an elliptical machine and it says you've burned 400 calories, you've actually only burned 300 calories. And again, you actually would have burned about 100 calories if you just sat on a couch. So there's only a difference of about 200 calories there. And then most people overestimate, because actually after they overestimate how much they burned, they underestimate the number of calories that they eat. And so they, you know, they justify in their mind that, hey, I can have this calamari appetizer from Applebee's, which is about 2,000 calories. Or they can have a chocolate thunder from down under at Outback Steakhouse, which is 1,500 calories. And so obviously that's the math is not adding up. And that's why people are not able to lose weight on cardio. Plus, there's research from the UK that found there's a group of people called compensators who actually get hungrier when they go on a cardio program. And so they eat an average of 300 extra calories per day. And that's why at the end of a 12-week cardio program, they've gained 3 pounds. And that's research proven in an actual medical journal. And so more proof, you don't need to do cardio.
So you can pre-order The Great Cardio Myth on Amazon now.
It's available now.
Okay. Yeah. All right, cool. So let me jump back to the perfect day formula. First question is, where does somebody go to find out more about that? And how do they get this really cool big orange box that I have on my desk right now?
They can go and watch a little video I made for them at perfectdayformula.com, which will talk about all the cool stuff that is in the kit and what it'll allow you to do, overcome that mental clutter, get totally dialed in with your vision, your clarity for your future, and create the rules and pillars for your life and your transformations.
So for those who do that, and for those this really resonates with, how do you work with people that want to take it to another level and really want to organize their life like you've organized it? You mentioned you work with people in a small group setting. How's that work?
Yeah. So I have something, another video at perfectlifeworkshop.com, and they can go and learn about my small group workshops. Again, they're only one person. I have one-on-one versions and I have five people in a small group version, and all the information about, you know, what they're going to get out of the day, how the day is going to go, is at perfectlifeworkshop.com. Those are in person. They're not virtual. They're in person. And I do them mostly in America, but some in Toronto. And then I have a couple dates in Europe this summer.
How often do you do those?
At least twice a month.
Okay.
Yeah.
So sometimes people come to you in Toronto, but sometimes you're doing them in the US also.
Yeah. Yeah. Because my office is in Denver for my business. I'm in California a lot. And I actually have one in Miami this weekend.
Oh, holy smokes. Well, if I weren't in the middle of a project, I'd drive down there and probably buy you a cup of coffee or something.
There you go. If I'd let you.
Yeah, if you let me. That's right. Because that's an unscheduled meeting. I
actually would not let you because I've never had a coffee in my life. So you'd have to buy me something else.
Oh my gosh. Don't get me started on coffee. That, by the way, that's my favorite vice. And I recently had to give that up, Craig.
You had to, why?
Let's just say that, unfortunately, I thought that I had avoided the addictive, whatever it is that runs in the Griffin side of my family's genes, but apparently not. Yeah, I had gone overboard on coffee. What was
your intake a day? Just curious.
Well, if I wanted to be delusional about it, I could say 3 cups a day, but these are 3 really large cups. So that could be probably 6 cups a day.
You see, I don't drink it because caffeine gives me anxiety. So, you know, if I was to have a coffee from Starbucks, I'd probably be running through windows.
If I
have 50 milligrams of caffeine in a day, that's good for 12 hours for me.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well,
it's all genetic. I have a certain genetic makeup and you have a different genetic makeup that allows you to metabolize it better than me.
I like the benefits of it, but it's to a point where, like, you know, too much is too much. And sure. So I wouldn't actually buy you a cup of coffee if I came down.
Fair enough. A scotch. Yeah.
I had a whole bunch of questions. We didn't get to it because we're actually at our hour point. So I hope you'll agree to
podcasts that I've done. And I did 103 last year. And this one went by about as fast as, probably faster than any of them. So it's good conversation.
Well, yeah, I feel the same way. I had a lot of fun, but I got so many questions left. So I hope you'll come back.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, cool. Thanks again, Craig. I appreciate it. I had a blast. And listen, everybody, you need to check out the Perfect Day Formula. Great way to get your anxiety under control, get your life under control, get your business under control. So thanks for putting that together, Craig. And thanks for being on the show.
Happy to help. Great to be here.
Thanks for listening. And remember, if you want to create rivers of revenue from your existing customers, then the next thing you need to do is go to DobermanDan.com. He's given away a free copy of his $98 per month Doberman Dan letter just for listening to the show. Go to DobermanDan.com now and sign up for your free issue.
This is the PodcastFactory.com.